Good morning and welcome to Central Parkway Baptist Church on this beautiful day in September. I believe it's the first official day of fall, and I know a few are hoping and praying for some cooler weather here soon, and all in good time. It's good to see everybody. Welcome. Glad to be able to worship with you. Thankful for each and every one of you, your part in the life of this church family. Just a few announcements as we begin here this morning. More for the Kingdom. This is the slide talking about the McGuire State Missions Offering. That is something that we participate in here in the month of September. And the dollars collected specifically for McGuire goes towards church planting efforts in the state of Florida. And so we've surpassed our goal. I think we're about at 2250. That's a wonderful thing. Glad to be able to participate in that. Also, next Sunday is a fifth Sunday. Every time it's a fifth Sunday or we have the opportunity, we enjoy being able to do something for our own local community here when we have folks that come in and request assistance. We're able to provide gift cards via your generosity to either Publix or Wawa or Walmart, that sort of thing. And so that's what we're collecting next Sunday. And also there will be a pumpkin patch meeting following this service in the fellowship hall. If you're going to volunteer, considering volunteering, wondering about what it's like to volunteer at the pumpkin patch, I'll invite you to stay along for that meeting. I believe lunch will be provided. A light lunch will be provided for everyone coming that day. And sign up is in the hallway right as you exit this door to the right. You could sign up for a shift on the first day to unload the pumpkins. That's always a big help. We need lots of folks to get those pumpkins unloaded. And then all throughout the month of October, there's opportunity to help out at the patch. And it culminates, you can sign up for having a trunk at our Trunk or Treat event, which is a safe alternative to trick-or-treating. And we always have tons of kids come through our parking lot on that day. Okay, very good. Let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we're thankful for the opportunity to worship you today. Lord, as we come, we pray that we could cast our burdens upon you because you care for us and that you receive all the glory and honor that's due your holy name. Capture our heart's affection and our mind's attention, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Good morning. Let's stand and sing This I Believe.
I believe in God, our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in you. I believe you rose again. I believe that Jesus Christ. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
I believe
in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son.
To describe how good is our God. Amen.
From the highest of hell to the depth of the sea, creation's revealing your majesty. From the colors of fall to the fragrance of spring, every creature unique in the that he sees, all exclaiming, indescribable, uncontainable. You blaze the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are an amazing God, all powerful, untamable, all strong. We fall to our knees. Stole every lightning bolt where it should go, or see heavenly storehouses laden with snow. Who imagined the sun and gave stars to its light, yet concealed is to bring us the coolness of. Uncontainable, you blaze the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing.
You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. Oh, powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim. You are amazing, God.
Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning, church. What an awesome day to be in the Lord's house. Man, we're just so blessed to have this great worship team behind us. I know that Josh is off today, but man, that's just fantastic. You know, who'd have thought that a year ago that Andrew would didn't say nothing to nobody. He's up here leading worship. So, man, that was a great job. So, I always find it amazing that in planning for my part in the service today, and then the song comes up, it's indescribable. What a perfect song. Our God, His plan is indescribable. Because if we could explain God, He wouldn't be God. Our missionary today is Clay. Clay felt the call to plant a church in his hometown of Cleveland, Ohio, bringing God's light to downtown Cleveland, and to then watch God do amazing things. It's indescribable to go and follow what God has, because we don't know what's around the corner, but yet Clay plants a church, and it continues to grow. And that church in the heart of downtown Cleveland is a light that continues to shine bright. But where does all that start? It all starts with prayer. Clay didn't go and just randomly throw a dart at a board and pick a spot. It's all through prayer. Having that conversation with God. Searching God. So as we enter our time of worship through prayer, please pray for missionaries like Clay that are church planters. Continue to pray for those like Stephen Van Bibber. You know, we talk about him every week. Sometimes it's up, sometimes we're down, right, Miss Janice? Okay, this week was a down week. We need to continue to pray for him. Pray for him, the doctors, the nurses, his family. And let me give you a new name. This gentleman's name is Anthony. Through a youth group, through another church that's very close with me, was in a car wreck up in Marion County on life support, but he's getting better. But we need to continue to pray for Anthony. We need to pray for those families that have lost loved ones. Miss Susan Hogan, that's in our first service, her mother passed away. The Dawson family, he's a youth pastor somewhere down south. His 32-year-old wife died. That's all I can figure out what happened. So with their kid, then so God's plan is great. We just don't know why people go, but we need to pray for those that are still here. Like the Dawson family, you know, like the Hogan family. We need to pray for what's going on in our country. We need to pray for what's going on in your life. So let's take a few moments. Let's bow our heads. Let's have that conversation with God. And I'll come back and close this shortly. Most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you. We thank you for this moment that you have created today. Lord, that your brothers and sisters have gathered in your house, Lord. Lord, you are the creator, the sustainer, and the healer, Lord. Your plan for each one of our lives is indescribable. Your love, your compassion, your mercy, your grace. But Lord, we are not worthy, Lord. We are not worthy of any of that. We have fallen short. We have given into the temptations of life, of this earth. But Lord, through the blessing of your Son going to that cross for each one of us, Lord, we thank you for that, Lord. Lord, we celebrate a new day because our days are numbered. We sit here right now, Lord, and the person to our right and to our left, we celebrate this time together. Because, Lord, there are families like the Hogan family and the Dawson family that is missing someone right now. Lord, we pray for those families. We pray for their losses. Lord, we pray for those at Parkview, Lord, that lost a member of their church. Lord, we pray for your peace upon them, Lord. Lord, we pray for Stephen and for Melissa and those that are suffering from cancer, Lord, going through the treatments, Lord. We pray for healing on their bodies. Lord, we pray for your comfort on their minds. Lord, we pray for the doctors and the nurses that are involved with that, Lord. Lord, I pray for Anthony, Lord, as he's still in a coma. Lord, I pray your hand will be upon him, Lord, upon his family. Lord, that your light, your radiant would shine through there. This is an opportunity, Lord. Lord, we just thank you for that, Lord. Lord, I pray for each one sitting in this room. The challenges of life, work, job, school, life, can be overwhelming. But Lord, thank you that we are not alone, that you are always with us. No matter where we go, you are there. You desire to be with your created ones. And Lord, as we continue to sing worship and praise to you, Lord, I ask that you open our hearts and our minds so that you would have for us on this day. We thank you and we praise you in your Son's name. Amen.
Let's stand and sing My Redeemer Lives. Seating.
Please join me in prayer. Most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you that you are a redeemer and that you live for each one of us. Lord, we're about to give back to you a small portion of what you've so graciously given. Bless the gift and the giver. In your Son's name, amen.
I'll invite you to take your copy of God's Word and turn in the Gospel, turn in your Bibles to the Gospel of Mark. And of course, our school-age children are invited to Children's Church. I say school-age, elementary age. Very good. Mark chapter 9, the verses will be displayed on the screens behind me. You could also follow along in your scripture. And the Bible's provided in the chair rack in front of you. The word of the Lord. They went on from there and passed through Galilee, and he did not want anyone to know, for he was teaching his disciples, saying to them, "The Son of Man is going to be delivered into the hands of men, and they will kill him. And when he is killed, after 3 days he will rise." But they did not understand the saying and were afraid to ask him. And they came to Capernaum. And when he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you discussing on the way?" But they kept silent, for on the way they had argued with one another about who was the greatest. And he sat down and called the 12, and he said to them, "If anyone would be first, he must be last of all and servant of all." And he took a child and put him in the midst of them, and taking him in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever receives one such child in my name receives me, and whoever receives me receives not me, but he who sent me." And may the Lord bless the reading of his word to our hearts and minds and our hands as we seek to not only be hearers but doers of the word of God. I remember as a child, and it's a memory that for some reason or another is very clear in my mind, being quite young, and the day outside was beautiful. The sky was a dark, or not a dark, but just a beautiful sky blue, and there was a large white puffy clouds interspersed in the sky. And that led me, for one reason or another, to inquire about this God business, about God. And I remember peppering my mom with questions about the Almighty, maybe triggered by Sunday school, but I feel it had something to do with the sky that I saw that day. And so I asked my mom, "Where does God live?" And my mom said, "Well, God lives in heaven." And then I asked the follow-up question, "And Mom, where is heaven?" And Mom said, "Well, heaven is somewhere out there beyond the clouds." And then I thought, "Well, how big is God?" And Mom said, "Well, God is too big to be measured." And then I said, "Then why can't I see God?" And Mom said, "Well, God is invisible." I think there's something in our core that causes us at one time or another in our lives to try to seek God out there, up there, wherever, in the beyond. We try to inquire about this being, the Almighty God. And so I think it's pretty natural across religion, and I think the reason for religion to a great extent is this phenomenon of trying to reach out, our attempt to ascend to, go up towards, reach out to God up there, out there, on our own. I think for a great extent, religion is viewed as an ascending religion. This is bore out in our Bible, right? Very on in the scriptures, in the book of Genesis, as they wandered, right, beyond Eden, that they were nomads. The people of earth were migrating. And the Bible talks about a group of people that said, "We're kind of tired of migrating. We're tired of moving around. This place where we are now looks okay. Why don't we just settle? And really not just settle, but we'll thrive here and we'll build up a tower. And the tower will ascend and reach where? Reach God, reach the heavens, touch God," right? That's how ancient, how primordial this desire to reach up and reach out and ascend and arrive at God. It's pictured more specifically with Moses, right? Moses is going to meet with God, and where does Moses go to meet with God? Up on the mountain, yeah. Psalm 24 asks the question, verses 3, "Who shall ascend to the hill of the Lord?" How do we reach up? How do we touch God? Who will ascend God's mountain? And who shall stand in his holy place? "He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not lift up his soul to what is false and does not swear deceitfully, he will receive blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. So the path of ascent assumes that God is up there or out there somewhere, and there's a way to reach God. There's a way to ascend, to find one place in understanding of who this God is, to be in this God's presence. Not just for the Judeo-Christian tradition, but other religions also ascribe to this ascent towards God. And many people would say that you have to be religiously superior in order to attain it or to ascend, right? You have to pray the right way. You have to pray the right words. You have to pray enough, long enough, loud enough, softly enough. You have to pray in a certain way. And if you pray in this way, then that's one way to ascend. Or maybe it's through other religious practices like fasting. If you fast enough, if you fast the right way and the right days, then you could ascend this holy hill. Or maybe it's about sacrificing enough, or giving the right sacrifices or the right amount. If only I give enough and give correctly, then I could ascend the holy hill. That's what religious practice seems to be about for a lot of folks. Or there's a moral ascent, right? I have to act in the right way. I have to do the right thing. I have to do enough of the right thing. I have to do certain laws or customs or norms. Or maybe I have to act in a way that refrains from doing certain things. I can't do this, I can't say that, I can't feel this way if I want to ascend that mountain. Another way to look at the path of ascending is intellectually, or maybe spiritual knowledge or certain knowledge, right? I have to know the right things. I have to know the right knowledge. I have to have the right catchphrases or the right passwords to get me past a certain level of, you know, of heaven. If I know the right word, and when St. Peter sees me at the pearly gates, if I say the right thing, then I could finally arrive, then I could finally ascend. It's about intellectual superiority. It's about religious superiority. It's about moral superiority. But Jesus, I would say, is revolutionary in introducing an alternative path. And if there's a path of ascension, then Jesus seems to be demonstrating the descending path. The descending path. Jesus left, the Bible talks about, the glory of heaven. Jesus humbled himself and became a man. Jesus lived his life serving others, washing their feet, healing them, teaching them, demonstrating compassion, feeding them. And he ultimately descended as low as the cross, and even death on the cross. And from that point on, the symbol of Christianity has been the cross. And I think it's this way because Jesus says in John chapter 14, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Jesus is not only our destination, but he's also the path to that destination. But as Jesus starts teaching about this path of descent to his disciples, and it seems like since the last chapter of Mark, chapter 8, he begins to change his focus, change his instruction in this way, talking about suffering, talking about death, talking about betrayal. Something goes on. There's a misfire or something doesn't land right with his disciples, right? And it's demonstrated again here in Mark 9, chapter 9, verse 32. But they did not understand the saying and were afraid to ask him. I believe they were so caught up in the path of ascent that they had no room on the shelf of their mind for this alternative path. They were so set on reaching out, climbing, attaining, that they couldn't listen. Malfunction, right? Fatal error or whatever. Something went wrong when Jesus started teaching about suffering. We know that that's true because the Bible says that when Jesus was teaching them that the Son of Man had to suffer and die, etc., and then be raised, the Bible says they didn't understand it. And instead of asking of Jesus what he meant, instead of trying to inquire about the path of descent, what did they do? On their way to Capernaum, they were arguing amongst themselves. And what was the topic of this argument? You remember? Yeah, who's the greatest? Who's better? Who's more important? Who's more popular? Who has more clout? Who has more sway? Who's next in line? Who's ascended more? Yeah? Who knows more? Who's better? Who's sharper? Who has more clout? It seems that we could make even the path of descent into a path of ascent, right? I fast, you know, more. I give more. I suffer more, and that way I'm better. I'm greater. I'm holier. And so it's very curious that on the path of ascent, we oftentimes end up not lifting one another up, but surpassing, excluding, stepping on someone in our search for God. In the epistles, right, in Paul's letters, we normally have an audience that's been stated. In other words, Paul's the author. He says, Paul and Timothy to the church of Corinth, or to the church, the church meeting in the home of, etc., to the Romans, that sort of thing. The Gospels, we don't have a stated audience. But a lot of New Testament scholars believe that Mark had an intended original audience. And so one of the things, it's not so popular anymore, but they used to practice this thing, it's called redaction criticism. It's where you try to find Mark's original audience using clues and cues from the gospel. And again, it's turned out to be very hard because it's not stated outward. You know, the origin or where Mark was writing from and where Mark was writing to is kind of hard to figure out because it's not stated in the gospel. But I think we have to agree that there was probably an original target, right? An original audience. And you would assume that Mark is wanting that audience to really kind of be eavesdropping on these conversations that Jesus was having with his apostles. Because human nature, well, one, we kind of like to eavesdrop. And we learn a lot from eavesdropping. Maybe call it gossip, I don't know. But I think Mark is wanting his audience to eavesdrop on these conversations. So I'm wondering if there's something going on in the audience that Mark is writing to, particularly surrounding this question of this fighting amongst each other, saying who's more important, who has more clout, who's greatest. I don't think that's too far of a stretch, because if you remember in Paul's letter to the Corinthian church, what's going on, right? He's writing to the Corinthians, and they have this problem. And what's their problem? Well, one of their problems are, hey, we think that Paul is the greatest of the disciples, right? No, no, it's Barnabas. We're from Barnabas. We're Barnabas's crew. And then the other folks in the church were saying, no, we're with Peter. Peter's the greatest. And others were saying still, no, we're with Jesus. All of you all have to step aside because we're with the Jesus crew or whatever. So is it possible that the reason that Mark, one of the reasons Mark is writing this to his audience is because it's so difficult to ascertain, or it's so difficult to get a grasp of Jesus' path of descent, because we all want to ascend. And we want to flip it. We even want to make the path of descent into a path of ascension, right? And one of the ways we do that is by this wanting to be important. It's a play of the ego. I wonder if Christianity today has confused the salvation of Christ with self-development. Acquiring more health, acquiring more wealth, having success in this world is a marker of God's blessing on our lives, and therefore a marker of attaining, of ascending, of arriving. And if the world offers us something, and if it advances our own cause, or it advances our ego, if it boasts us, if it boosts us, then we have ways to baptize it and call it Jesus or call it Christianity, when all the while it bears no mark or no resemblance to the Jesus of history. In our text, Jesus provides one practical way, I think, here of how to live out this path of descent, or the descending path. Jesus, I think, here is referring, obviously, to the practice of hospitality. The practice of hospitality. We see that the disciples with Jesus arrived in Capernaum, right? Verse 33, and they came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you discussing on the way?" Jesus had a home base, I believe, there in the region of the town of Capernaum. In order to conduct ministry, he had to have this home base, and so we don't know who it was, but somebody hosted Jesus. And the practice of hospitality, right, is if you're greeted or welcomed into a home, you're oftentimes greeted with an embrace or with a kiss, a welcome. Yeah, you're maybe led to sit down so that the servant or the homeowner, whatever, could come and wash the street off your feet, right? The dust from your feet, refresh you in that way. And then, of course, offer a snack or a meal in honor of your presence there, right? It's a way to show hospitality. That was a common way to show hospitality. And I'm assuming that that's what Jesus and his disciples received here in this home in Capernaum, and what they enjoy, because it was customary. It's an honor-shame society, meaning kind of like a lot of ways in today, right? Who you invite into your home, whose home you're invited into, might be a way to raise your clout or raise your importance or raise your significance. So you want to have important people in your home, because by default that means that, hey, you must be pretty important yourself. You want to be invited to important people's homes because that must mean that, hey, you're important. That's how it was. And so they arrive in this home. They've been discussing amongst themselves this whole issue of who's greatest. They've probably received, like I said, the customary embrace, the customary foot washing, the customary snack or meal. And Jesus, looking down, finds one of the children. Now, in this day and age, a child really is property of the homeowner. The child is property. The child doesn't have clout. The child doesn't really have much honor. He could bring honor to his parents, but he can't really bring you any honor by your knowing this child. Again, he's property. So Jesus looks down and brings this child in the middle of them all, and then lifts him up and gives him a big hug and says, if you welcome this little child, you are welcoming me. If you welcome this little child that really can't make you more important, really can't give you any clout, can't give you any honor, can't boost your standing with anybody, if you welcome this little child, you're welcoming me. And guess what? You're not really welcoming me if you welcome this little child. You're welcoming he who sent me. You're welcoming God. If you descend to pick up this child who has no clout, who's really has no way of providing for himself, let alone providing for anybody else, who has no way of giving you anything, if you reach down and welcome this child, provide hospitality for this child, for one of the least of these, if you provide hospitality for somebody who really can't do anything back for you, then you are welcoming me, and more than that, you're welcoming God. Jesus' call to his disciples is also his call to us. True greatness isn't found in rising above others, but in humbling ourselves to serve. We are called to follow the downward path of Christ, pouring out our lives in love and service to others. And so a question, right, for application. Even this week, how could we descend into greatness in our own lives? At work, this week, how could you serve your colleagues, even when or especially when it goes unnoticed by your boss or by your colleagues? At home, how could you put your family members and their needs above your own? In church, how could you seek out opportunities to serve rather than to be served? In your community, and I think this is the clincher, how could you share and care and display compassion to the least of these? Now, 100%, I believe that the lives of children, Jesus raises up their status, right, from being just property to being of value in God's eyes. That's kind of, I mean, children aren't viewed in the same way today in our culture, in our day and age, as they were in Jesus' culture and in Jesus' day and age. But there are others that might be, right? Others that, by welcoming them, by embracing them, by serving them, can't really bring you any clout or any position or any honor or advance your cause. But it's a descent into an introduction to God. How could we show care and compassion for the least of these in our communities today? Jesus invites us to follow him on the path of descending to greatness. Will we embrace the call to humble ourselves and serve others, trusting that in the kingdom of God, the last will be first? There's a story about a man, this is an old story, from the days of the Desert Fathers, which were people that went out, they left, they didn't like the way that the things that were going on in the cities with the churches, and they kind of wanted to seek God out in the middle of nowhere. So they created these communities in the desert. So there was a man who heard about the leader of this particular community and wanted an audience with him. This man was a religious man. He was considered a pious man in his community, and so he wanted to meet this famous spiritual guy in the desert. And so he said to one of the monks when he got there, "Would you please be so kind as to introduce me to see the father," which is the leader of the community, what they call the leader of the community. So this monk brought the visitor to the old man and presented him, saying, "This is a great man, full of charity. He's held in high esteem in his district. I have spoken to him about you, and he has come because he wants to see you." So this father received this Christian man with great joy. They greeted one another, and then they sat down. And this visitor wanted to find out. He wanted to talk to this holy man, so he started to talk to him and wanted to know about the scriptures and of heaven and of all these spiritual things. And the old monk didn't answer a word. He was silent, and he even turned his face. Now, this grieved this man greatly. He had traveled all this way. And so he left his presence, and he went to talk to the monk that introduced him to the head of the order. And he said, "I've traveled all this way to meet this holy man, and he won't say anything to me. I'm so discouraged." And so this monk kind of felt bad, so he went and he spoke to the head of the order, and he said, "Father, this man has traveled a long distance, and he's well regarded in his community. He's well esteemed, and he came to seek an audience with you." And the old monk said, "This man came, and he wanted to speak about the scriptures and heavenly things." And he said, "I don't know anything about all that. I'm a lowly man. If he were to want to ask me about the sins of the flesh or the pressures of this world, I could speak to him about those things." And so this man went out and told this man that had come to visit. He said, "The father is really reluctant to speak about the scriptures and about heaven. But he says if you would want to talk about the sins of the soul, he might speak with you." And this caused this man to repent. And he returned to the old man and said to him, "What should I do? The sins of my flesh, the ways of this world, master me." The old monk turned towards him and replied joyfully, "This time you come as you should. Now open your mouth concerning this, and I will fill it with good things." Greatly edified, this man said to him, "Truly, this is the right way." And he returned to his own country, giving thanks to God that he has been counted worthy to meet so great a saint. I think we all want to, in our hearts, right, in our souls, we want to ascend the holy mountain. We want to be saved. We want to know and experience God and share God. And these are all good things. But oftentimes we mistake the way there, and we live our lives upside down. And Jesus came and took the form of a bondservant, of a slave, and even to the point of the cross and death on a cross. Jesus died. And it's when Jesus reached the lowest parts of this world and experiencing death in all of its fullness that he opened up that tomb and realized the resurrection. And so it's the descending path. It's the path of descent that leads to God. Let's pray. Gracious and Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time together. And we thank you that Jesus opened up his mouth and told his disciples that the Son of Man was going to have to suffer and be betrayed and be killed and on the third day rise again. God, we ask that we're not like the disciples that couldn't understand this and were afraid to ask. Help us to be, God, those that inquire about these hard sayings. And when called upon, God, not to have our head in the clouds, but even see you in the lowliest or in the least of these. And help us, God, not to be so full of ego that we're not doing the work of God on earth. We pray these things together in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Church, we're going to stand and sing a hymn of, or a song of response and invitation. Oh, come to the altar. Church, again, don't rush out without encouraging somebody, shaking somebody's hand, especially if you don't recognize them. They might be visiting our church today for the first time, and we don't want them to leave here thinking, you know, yeah, these folks, they weren't very friendly, you know. Maybe I'll never go back there. That's the last thing we want people to say, and for the most part, they don't. I think we're really a friendly group of folks, so make sure that we're that way today. I had an inquiry last week at the end of the service about someone wanting to be baptized, and so I thought there might be others that might want to do that as well. So I forgot to announce it in the first service, but I'm thinking about not next Sunday, but the Sunday after, of starting a new members and a baptism class. And so if that's something that you might be interested in, you could come talk to me, and we'll work that out. We'll get it. I'll get you signed up. That would probably happen during the Sunday school hour, okay, which is about 10 o'clock. May the Lord bless you and keep you, cause his face to shine upon you, be gracious to you, lift up his countenance upon you, and give you peace. Church, we'll see you again real soon.